Hey everyone, this is Michael again, and welcome to the Friday Night SmackDown review. And SmackDown tonight, of course, was from the Performance Center in Orlando. And I gotta say, SmackDown tonight wasn't a terrible show. Thought the show was okay, in my opinion. We saw in the main event, Bayley versus Nikki Cross, where the SmackDown Women's Championship was on the line. We saw, of course, once again, Lacey Evans versus Naomi. And we had a little heel turn that we saw tonight, but it wasn't big, it wasn't huge, so which I will get to that. And we saw AJ Styles versus Grand Metalik, where the Intercontinental Championship was on the line. Where Grand Metalik won that Fatal 4-Way last week. But SmackDown was an okay show tonight. So let's jump right into the review. So SmackDown opened up with a video package from Bayley and Sasha. Bayley ended up talking about how she's going to defeat Nikki Cross. Later on in the night, we had Morrison and The Miz sending a warning out to Big E. And they're laughing at the idea of Big E having a singles run now that, you know, Xavier Woods has been out for a while. Now Kofi Kingston is out. So they were just making fun of Big E for going on the singles run. And we saw Lacey Evans, shooting on Naomi, and we have Grand Metalik and AJ Styles having words, you know, before their match. So then, after all those video packages, we had a Firefly Funhouse, and Bray Wyatt ended up appearing, and he ended up saying that he's sorry that he was late, as he was out looking for Braun Strowman still. So Bray Wyatt ended up joking the part of Braun Strowman's spirit will always be there in the swamp, because he was joking about, you know, how Braun Strowman might still be in the bottom of the swamp. You know, maybe gators got to him. So Bray Wyatt ended up talking about that. So we end up seeing, you know, flashes, of course, of the Swamp match. And Bray Wyatt end up making it clear that he never wanted to hurt Braun Strowman. So Bray Wyatt end up saying now he, meaning, of course, The Fiend, wants Braun Strowman. And something that Strowman has. So Bray Wyatt end up saying until he gets what he wants, none of you are safe. So we saw flashes of The Fiend. And then we saw Bray Wyatt end up looking straight ahead at the camera. And he ended up saying, let me in. And so he snaps out of that whole trance. And then he just waves goodbye to the viewers. And that's how the Firefly Funhouse ended. So, but It was pretty decent. Firefly Funhouse. And then we went to the first match of the night. It was Grand Metalik versus AJ Styles, and the Intercontinental Championship was on the line because, of course, Grand Metalik won the Fatal 4-Way last week. And this was a very good match. This was a good match between Metalik and Styles. This was a surprisingly good match, in my opinion. So it was back and forth between Styles and Metalik. And at the end of the match, you had Styles end up locking in the calf crusher to Grand Metalik. And Lindsay Dorado, of course, was on the outside at ringside. Watching the match. So like I said, Styles ended up blocking the Calf Crusher on Metalik, on Grand Metalik. Metalik ended up tapping out. So there you go. Styles ended up winning the match, retaining the Intercontinental Championship, which we all knew he was going to retain. Grand Metalik was, of course, never winning the Intercontinental Championship. So, you know, we all knew the outcome of the match. So, but post-match, you had Styles end up making his way out of the ring, but he ended up stopping, and he ended up taking out Lince Dorado, and Styles end up picking up Lince Dorado and hit the Styles Clash on Lince Dorado, and you know, that was that. Before that, he was still being up on Grand Metalik. But overall, surprisingly, good match from Metalik and Styles. So, and then we went backstage and we saw, Baron Corbin, Baron Corbin. I don't know why they're still calling him King Corbin. Can we drop the king already from Corbin's name? So he walked up on Chad Gable. Chad Gable was watching what happened in the ring, and, you know, with Styles being up on Metalik and Lince Dorado. So Corbin was talking up to Chad Gable, saying that he could have been out there competing. Gable ended up telling Corbin that, you know, so now they're just supposed to be friends, because, you know, the whole feud between Gable and Corbin, where, you know, which I'll get to explaining later because of what happened in at the end of Corbin and Drew Gulak's match. So Corbin ended up saying that they've always been friends. Really? Really? Didn't we just see you have a match, you know, a feud with him and Gable, with you and Gable? Really, Corbin? That you've always been friends with Gable? What? So Corbin ended up going on about how Chad Gable has been overlooked, and he ended up saying, and quote, idiots, barefoot idiots, come in and get the opportunities. So Chad Gable ended up saying, oh, I see what's happening. And, you know, Corbin, you know, just wants Gable to take out Matt Riddle. So Corbin ended up dismissing that idea. And he ended up saying that he just wants Gable to see how he's being done wrong in the company. And Corbin ends up saying that that the King's Ransom is still on the table and there for Chad Gable if he wants to be the one that takes Matt Riddle out. So that was that. And then we went to Jeff Hardy coming out. Jeff Hardy ended up coming off that bar fight last week with Sheamus, which, you know, was fine. You know, was fine for what it was last week. I didn't find that bar fight, you know, terrible. It was just fine. So Jeff Hardy was in the ring. He ended up getting on the mic, and he ended up saying that he hasn't felt this good in a long time. He ended up saying that these past months with Sheamus have been tough, and he has been a consistent reminder of how dangerous his demons are. Can be. He ended up saying sobriety will be a never-ending challenge, and he has to face that every day. Jeff Hardy went on to say that beating Sheamus in the bar fight was a reminder that he is on the right path. He also ended up saying that he's an alcoholic, but he's so much more than that. Jeff Hardy went on to say that he is a loving father, a loving husband, and he's a WWE superstar. Jeff Hardy went on to say that he gets to perform in the ring for the fans, and he absolutely loves doing that. So he went on and he ended up saying that he never wants to let anyone down again. He said the struggle is real and he will fight it every day. He also went on to say that he is grateful to be here. So then he got interrupted by Corbin. Corbin came out and said that he was tired of hearing Jeff Hardy talk about his sobriety. He ended up saying that Jeff Hardy is the charismatic enigma. And he's like, oh, what's up with all the crying and whining about recovery? So Corbin ends up mentioning the problems with Matt Riddle and also his match with Drew Gulak, which he had. Corbin ends up saying that he feels like he's losing his mind, like his kingdom is an insane asylum. So Jeff Hardy ended up saying that maybe the real problem is Corbin himself. So then Corbin ends up talking shit on Jeff Hardy. And then Drew Gulak ends up attacking Corbin from behind on the stage. And then SmackDown went to commercial. So what are we going to get? We're going to get Jeff Hardy versus Corbin already now. We're going to have, two-on-one handicap match with Matt Riddle and Jeff Hardy taking on Corbin. That's my prediction there. But who knows if WWE is going to book that. They might as well book that. No, that's typical WWE logic there. So then we had Gulak versus Corbin. Match was just meh. In my opinion, didn't really care for it. Corbin ended up getting the win with the End of Days because Matt Riddle ends up coming out. He came out to distract Corbin, and Drew Gulak ended up rolling up Corbin, but Corbin ended up kicking out. And then Corbin came right back, hit the End of Days to Gulak, and that was that. Corbin ended up winning. And I did not care. So post-match, Matt Riddle ended up rushing into the ring, beat down on Corbin. And then we had Chad Gable comes from behind and ends up hitting a German suplex on Matt Riddle. And he dropped Matt Riddle on his head. So Gable ends up standing tall. He ends up looking back at Corbin. And we hear Chad Gable, mention to Corbin, about, the gesture for the money. So that was that. So Chad Gable ends up turning heel. It wasn't a big heel turn. It wasn't a shocking heel turn. So it was just, okay, Chad Gable turns heel. But he's only turning heel because for the money. I'm like, you turn this guy heel, you line him with Corbin there. Weren't these guys having a feud before? And right now, WWE wants to put Chad Gable with Corbin just to make a gesture of money. Really? Wow. So then we had Big E versus The Miz. This was Big E's first match as a singles competitor in a long while. Without Kofi Kingston and Xavier Woods. This reminds me of when Big E was, a singles competitor. Way before Xavier Woods and Kofi Kingston came into play and they formed the New Day. So it's been a long while since we've seen Big E as a singles competitor. And he did pretty good in this match. You know, this match, you know, was a decent match. You had John Morrison out there, of course. There was a point where Morrison ended up getting involved, and it led to The Miz hitting the skull crushing finale. The Miz ended up, John Morrison ended up kicking Big E, big knee to Big E's face. Miz ended up coming back, followed back with the skull crushing finale. Miz went for the pin, and Big E surprisingly kicked out at two. So then Morrison ends up getting involved again. He got on the ring apron, and the referee ended up seeing him because he laid a cheap shot to Big E. The referee ended up seeing him. The referee then threw Morrison out of ringside. So Miz was pleading with the referee, and Miz was insisting the referee that Morrison didn't really do anything wrong. And so that's when Big E came from behind, rolled up the Miz. Miz kicked out of two. And then Big E went right into the stretch muffler submission. Miz ended up tapping out. So there you go. Big E ended up winning by submission. So, you know, it was a decent match between Big E and the Miz. You know, like I said, this was Big E's first match as a singles competitor in a long while. A long time. So then we had Cesaro and Nakamura backstage. They were celebrating. Lince Dorado and Grand Metalik end up coming up. Nakamura ends up asking them both if they like to party. And they end up saying that they do. So Cesaro end up reminding them that this is a party for champions only. So they end up taunting Grand Metalik for blowing his shot at the Intercontinental Championship against Styles earlier in the night. So they were just taunting the Lucha House Party, and that was that. So what are we going to get? We're going to get Cesaro and Nakamura versus the Lucha House Party next. See them doing that. We might possibly get that next week. I wouldn't be surprised if we see that next week. Cesaro Nakamura versus Lucha House Party and Lince Dorado and Grand Metalik. So then we had Sheamus. Sheamus was backstage. Sheamus went on to say that his first mistake in the bar fight was putting Jeff Hardy in a bar, giving him advantage, home field advantage. He went on to say that even though not a drop of booze touched Jeff's lips, Jeff was powered by alcohol. Sheamus ended up saying that he was basically in a handicap match against Jeff Hardy and his lifelong friend, alcohol. Sheamus ended up saying that he's not here to make excuses and complain. What's done is done. He wanted to say that it's just a matter of time before Jeff Hardy ends up slipping up again. He says he will just watch as nature takes its course, as Jeff Hardy is not his problem anymore. Thank God. Thank God the feud is over. So Sheamus ended up saying this is bad news for the SmackDown locker room, because Sheamus is their problem now. So that was that. So who is going to be Sheamus's next opponent? We will have to wait and see. But thank God that feud is over with between Jeff Hardy and Sheamus. Then we had Lacey Evans versus Naomi. Terrible match. Naomi ended up winning. Lacey Evans went to go for a woman's right. Naomi ended up counter it, backslide Lacey Evans into the three count. So there you go. Naomi ended up winning. Post-match, Lacey Evans was shocked. And Lacey Evans ended up going to the announce table, starts ranting. And she ends up yelling at Corey Graves for Court Grace to start a hashtag for how she deserves better. So that was that, but terrible match. So now we have Mandy Rose and Otis backstage. Mandy Rose and Otis, both of them haven't been seen in like a month. So it's good to see them back on WWE television. They were the best thing on WWE television and on SmackDown. So Mandy Rose ended up saying that it feels like a long time since they've had a proper date. So she ended up booking a table at Otis's favorite barbecue spot. And she ended up going on teasing him. And she ended up having a description of a peach dessert. And Otis was loving it. Rose ended up telling Otis to go get ready. And she will do the same. And then they will meet back. So Mandy Rose and Otis went their separate ways. And we see Sonya Deville walk from behind. And she was listening to what was going on. She didn't look too happy. And Sonya Deville is another one who hasn't been seen on TV in a month. And then we saw Mandy Rose. She was putting on her makeup. Sonya Deville ends up attacking out of nowhere. And when Sonya and Mandy were going at it, the screen glitched like it was doing like a month ago. So Sonya Deville ended up talking shit to Mandy Rose while she was beating Mandy down. The screen was glitching a whole lot more. And Sonya Deville ended up attacking Mandy Rose, still attacked Mandy Rose. Kicked Mandy Rose's face into the floor. And then we saw Sonya Deville ends up grabbing a pair of scissors. She grabbed the scissors and started cutting some of Mandy's hair off. Sonya Deville ends up saying that Mandy ended up ruining her life. And that she, Sonya, is going to ruin Mandy's. So Sonya Deville was like, oh, you didn't believe me. So Sonya ends up sending Mandy Rose back down to the floor. Sonya Deville went to go grab the other makeup. Sonya Deville ended up going to the makeup table. And she ended up looking around. She ends up grabbing a pair of clippers. And she ends up turning them on. She goes to shave Mandy's head. But then, you know, we had referees come and break it up. And Sonya Deville ended up grabbing a chunk of Mandy Rose's hair off the ground. She ended up saying that she has what she wants. So Sonya ended up leaving. Mandy Rose was on the ground sobbing. So it was a crazy beatdown by Sonya Deville. It was pretty good. Pretty good what happened, between Sonya and Mandy back there. And Sonya Deville going nuts on Mandy. And then Kayla Braxton, we saw her backstage where referees were checking on Mandy Rose. We saw Otis and Tucker checking on Mandy. So The Miz and John Morrison walk up to Kayla Braxton. So they start cracking jokes about the situation that happened, you know, with Sonya and Mandy. And Tucker ends up hearing that. Tucker ends up yelling at both The Miz and John Morrison to get out of here. And that was that. But crazy beatdown by Sonya Deville. Really enjoyed it. But it's like the Mandy Rose and Sonya Deville feud, not over yet. And so then we had the main event. Nikki Cross versus Bayley for the SmackDown Women's Championship. Nikki Cross also comes out with Alexa Bliss. Bayley, of course, along with Sasha, came out So the match itself, it was a okay match. Nikki Cross and Bayley. Bayley ended up, Nikki Cross ended up going for Bayley. Bayley ended up dodging her, and both of them lock up. Bayley ends up kicking Nikki Cross, and Nikki Cross end up beating Bayley into the corner. And towards the end of the match, you had Nikki Cross end up ducking a clothesline from Bayley, and Bayley ends up coming back, ends up dropping Nikki Cross. There you go. Bayley ended up winning the match, retaining the SmackDown Women's Championship. That was that, but we all knew Bayley was going to retain anyway. So post-match, we had Alexa Bliss. She ended up checking on Nikki Cross. Nikki Cross ended up getting to her feet. Bliss ended up apologizing to Nikki Cross. She ended up trying to talk to her. Cross ended up shoving Bliss to the mat. And she ends up walking off. So it looks like it's maybe a Nikki Cross, maybe the Nikki Cross heel turn right here. Because a lot of people were like, oh, is Alexa Bliss going to turn heel on Nikki Cross? Are we going to see it tonight? But now it's looking at, as I was looking at it, I was like, Nikki Cross is possibly going to do something to Alexa Bliss. So, we saw Nikki Cross end up shoving Alexa Bliss. So Alexa Bliss was alone in the ring, and suddenly the lights go out in the performance center. And they come back on, and we see The Fiend. The Fiend is standing behind Alexa Bliss, and I really enjoyed this whole thing with Alexa Bliss and The Fiend here. So The Fiend was circling around Alexa Bliss, and The Fiend ends up kneeling down near Alexa Bliss. So The Fiend then starts staring at Alexa. He raises his hand. The Fiend raises his hand for the Mandible Claw. So The Fiend ends up slowly bringing his hand back, and he puts the Mandible Claw, he locks in the Mandible Claw on Alexa Bliss. And pretty much that was basically that. The Fiend ended up taking Alexa Bliss to the mat. And that was that. But I really enjoyed this whole thing with Alexa Bliss and The Fiend. Of course, they showed Alexa Bliss in the swamp match. So I think Alexa Bliss is going to be the Sister Abigail. I see that, see them doing that. So I think that's why The Fiend did that to Alexa Bliss and locked in the Mandible Claw. Something to do with with Bray Wyatt, with Alexa Bliss. So but really enjoyed that. That ending was awesome. And I love seeing The Fiend back on WWE TV. But that was SmackDown tonight. Overall, okay show. Wasn't terrible. Anyways, that's it for the SmackDown review. Thank you all for watching. Hope you all enjoyed this review. And definitely give the video a thumbs up, comment, subscribe, and until next video, which will be up tomorrow, it's going to be a unboxing from Ringside Collectibles. Got a new Elite, one that I was waiting for them to put out. So I'm going to unbox that tomorrow. So until that video, I'll see you all later.